have to do this. Justice's envoy and Bassett wanted me to extend my regrets for their inability to be here today, but I want you to know, as I'm sure you do, that they are very strong supporters of the campaign.
Judge Rivera.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Chief Justice Lynn, for that very generous introduction. And thank you to all the members of the court who were so kind and welcomed me so warmly yesterday on a lovely tour of the Supreme Court and a very nice lunch. And I learned a great deal about how you choose cases. Apparently, it's not so different from how we choose cases, and it's not so different how we assign cases, although I like your picture a lot better than the cards. We were discussing how we do this anonymously. Apparently they have a picture and they put the case name in and they pick it. I hope this was not a secret. No, apparently it's out. Secret's out, no secret. We do it with just, we're not so highfalutin, as they say. We just have an index card on the table and we just pick it up, and that's how we learn what the case is that we're going to write on. So there's the secret for the New York State Court of Appeals also. Quite high tech. Anyway, thank you again, really, for inviting me. Good morning to all of you, and indeed it is quite a wonderful, wonderful room. I know it's been a long morning, although a very inspiring morning, and so I will tell you that my comments are superbly brief, but they're not so superbly brief, but I've cut back some of it. They may have noticed at the table. But it's really my pleasure to join you today. And to deliver these comments on one of the legal profession's priorities, ensuring that every person, regardless of status or station, has access to quality legal assistance. You know as well as I, because that's why you're here, that for the moment there is a significant justice gap in the delivery of civil legal services. There is a shortfall between the demand for civil legal assistance by those who simply cannot afford it but desperately need representation, and the access to available no-fee or low-cost-fee civil legal assistance. Where a person's home, employment, or financial resources are in jeopardy, it is incumbent upon the legal profession to ensure that no individual faces legal action without a lawyer to advise and guide. The guarantee of legal assistance is not a promise that a client will secure a particularly favorable outcome, but an assurance that the client has a lawyer to voice the client's concerns in the process, one that is able to address the legal issues and articulate the client's position. In other words, a knowledgeable lawyer who is a strong advocate for their client. Apart from the moral imperative that it is simply the right thing to do to provide the poor or persons of moderate means with a lawyer when they face, for example, eviction, foreclosure, predatory lending scams, consumer swindles, or loss of safety net resources, I think we cannot ignore the structural imperative to close the justice gap. Our democratic system cannot survive so long as there are members of our community who are subject to legal proceedings without representation, solely because they lack the means to pay for the services of an attorney. Our system of justice depends on that one word, justice. If our communities believe that the rule of law applies unevenly, that there is one set of rules for the privileged and another set of rules for everyone else, that the wealthy can avoid the consequences of their violations of the law because they can hire an attorney, that the legal system tilts in favor of those with money and against the poor, that judges decide cases based on the person appearing in front of them and not on the facts and legal standards, then, my friends, we are truly lost. The integrity of our legal system, of the legal profession, depends on the provision of legal services to everyone, regardless of ability to pay, and we cannot lose confidence in our system of justice lest we risk chaos and despair. That is why we have worked so hard in New York State, as you have here, to close our justice gap. And that is why the work of New Hampshire's legal services community is critically important, not only to ensure legal assistance for the indigent and individuals with low income, but also to protect the integrity of the rule of law and inspire respect for our system of justice and our judiciary. In preparation for this morning's comments, I have studied up on your efforts to close the justice gap in New Hampshire, and I'm sure my studies will fall short, and I know you will forgive me. But I have been impressed by the scope of the work that you have accomplished here. For over four decades, New Hampshire Legal Assistance has provided civil legal services statewide for the elderly and those of low income. Your work on domestic violence and to ensure access to public benefits and housing, with a focus not only on the individual cases but on systemic change, has without doubt helped individuals and their families and brought stability in uncertain times to your clients. I'm also pleased to see that you have a youth law and a senior law project. The generational spectrum is well represented by these projects, and they are a reminder of how we must take care of our neighbors from the stressors of life and the uncertainty and fear associated with poverty and the vulnerability that comes both with youth and progressive age. And I am keenly aware of that last one, may I say. Now then, of course, you have New Hampshire's Rule of Professional Conduct 6.1 that states unequivocally that every lawyer has a professional responsibility to provide legal services to those unable to pay, and that a lawyer should aspire to render at least 30 hours of pro bono publico legal services per year. Now that is really an important message for new and established lawyers and those who put in all those pro bono hours, that this is critical to closing the justice gap. Having been a public interest lawyer myself, I know how important it is that those who do not spend their time in the public sector nevertheless give their hours generously to this public service project of closing the gap. Now, the Supreme Court has also created the New Hampshire Access to Justice Commission to improve access to the courts after finding that, quote, gaps exist in developing a comprehensive, integrated, statewide civil legal services delivery system in New Hampshire, resulting in, quote, many people included, including those who are currently eligible for free legal services, as well as those who do not qualify for such programs, but are in fact unable to afford the cost of legal services and forced to represent themselves. Your court has thus made clear that achieving a committed and active justice community in New Hampshire is essential to the effective delivery of civil legal services. Even with that commitment to close the justice gap and the great work that you are doing here, the shortfall remains. The February 2013 study of the legal needs of New Hampshire's low-income residents, commissioned by the Access to Justice Commission and the Legal Advice and Referral Center, quote, found that low-income people face a number of barriers in addressing their legal problems. Some of them more obvious, such as the lack of available legal services and physical access issues, and some of them more subtle, such as a lack of knowledge that a legal remedy exists or lack of faith in the justice system. That latter is the one that I tell you we must change. The report also found that the single greatest barrier identified by all data sources was the lack of adequate legal services to meet the legal needs of low-income people in New Hampshire. The mismatch between legal needs and services has numerous ramifications, the report explained. Most importantly, it makes a material difference to low-income people already in difficult circumstances for whom legal help might make the difference between staying in their home or receiving needed public benefits. The justice gap also leads to a surprisingly high rate of self-representation in New Hampshire state courts, an estimated 61 to 70% overall. Individuals without legal representation are at a disadvantage compared to those who have it and put a strain on the court system. The report further stated, while there is a right to legal representation for criminal cases, no such guarantee is extended to low-income people in civil cases. This means that in many important legal matters, including child custody, home foreclosure, domestic violence, and landlord-tenant disputes, low-income residents often must navigate the legal system on their own or opt to not address their legal needs at all. The effect is a stark justice gap between the legal needs of low-income people and the services available to them. The findings described, of course, in that 2013 report are not unique to New Hampshire, although uniquely experienced by your community, but they reflect a national problem that continues today. According to the Legal Services Corporation's 2017 Justice Gap Report, more than 60 million Americans, live at 125% of the federal poverty line or below, which is $30,750 or less for a family of four. The report found that 86% of the civil legal problems faced by low-income individuals in a given year received inadequate or no legal help. Of 1.7 million civil legal problems for which low-income individuals seek legal services funded legal aid, 1 to 1.2 million, or 62 to 72%, receive inadequate or no legal assistance. The numbers are staggering. In 2017, low-income individuals will not get their legal needs fully met for approximately 1 million civil legal problems they present to legal services funded programs due to the limited resources of these programs. The Access to Justice Commission's 2017 report noted that in 2013, only 1% of tenants in housing court, 1%, were represented by an attorney. Outrageous. And by 2016, the number had risen to 27%. Obviously, we are in desperate need of services for those who cannot afford it. And these services, the lawyers and the judges in the room know, make a difference, because a person represented by counsel is in a better position, regardless of the nature of the case, than an unrepresented person. The point of fact is that it is not only morally right and essential to the survival of our democracy and justice system to close the justice gap, but for those who really need more than that lofty reason, it simply makes economic sense to reduce the number of unrepresented individuals in civil proceedings. I will go by our own experience. New York State's independent research showed that for every dollar invested in civil legal services, $5 to $6, or even on occasion $10, are returned to the state. This is no small amount of money. The same results were found by an independent analysis of the economic benefits of New Hampshire's legal services programs, as described in the 2013 New Hampshire Statewide Economic Impact Report. The report summarized that the analysis projected that New Hampshire civil legal services in 2012 would generate $26 million over the next 10 years in ongoing income for low-income residents through successful advocacy for federal benefits, including Social Security, disability benefits, tax refunds. These benefits provide an immediate and sustained boost to your economy, generating, the report said, $42.7 million in additional economic activity 10 years for local businesses, landlords, hospitals, pharmacies, and other healthcare providers when legal services clients use these funds to pay their bills, buy food and clothing, and obtain health care. Now, I myself find it truly unseemly to talk about money, but I'm not a fool. And you already have very bright young people who remind us that money indeed matters. And so, again, if no one needs any other reason, based on morals or our rule of law, I hope that the numbers, the economics, impresses upon everyone that this is what we have to do to ensure the survival of our communities and our system of justice. As I say, these numbers make that solid case for funding, fully funding, civil legal services. And in New York, we have focused on addressing that justice gap by two approaches. The first, of course, although I say I don't like to talk about money, but it is our reality. First, we have put money into legal services. As federal funding was cut, our former Chief Judge, Jonathan Lipman, used his tremendous skills and powers of persuasion to secure funding from our state and local governments. Between 2009 and 2015, funding for legal services increased from $12.5 million to $100 million. As a designated sum in our judiciary budget. Why did we commit to funding legal services through our budget, even as we suffered budget cuts to this branch of government? Because he viewed this not as a budgetary issue, but as a justice issue. In a recent speech describing this choice, and I must say, I do not know that I could have made that choice if I was in his shoes, and I know that there are many who criticize this choice. But this is the way he described this choice. We in the profession have to stand for something, and advocating for legal representation for the most vulnerable in society is our most fundamental obligation. We are not here just to feather our own nest. Lesson in point, and I'm speaking and quoting him, "At the beginning of my tenure as the chief judge, the governor and the legislature cut $170 million from the judiciary budget, a great deal of money by any standard, even in a state as large as New York. A budget cut of that size necessarily required layoffs of court personnel. At the same time, I had pledged to give millions of dollars to legal services for the poor in the judiciary budget. The other two branches of government asked, how can you lay people off and possibly close the doors of the courthouses at the same time that you're giving money to legal services organizations that are representing poor people? The answer I gave was that if we keep the courthouse doors open and don't have equal justice inside, then we might as well close the doors. In those circumstances, justice does not mean anything. So we gave the monies to legal services providers and we did what we had to do and laid off court personnel, most of whom, I'm pleased to say, we were able to return to the court system within a reasonable period of time. We agonized about this choice, and in the end made our point that the judiciary and the profession believed that access to justice for all was the very foundation of the courts and the justice system. Now, again, I don't know that I would have made that choice. I don't know how many people could have made that choice, but he felt it was the right choice, and it eventually garnered for us a huge increase in the judicial budget. And the reality is that no one but that particular individual could have carried that off so successfully. But in addition to that choice and the pain that went with it, our doors were closed and it was a very difficult time for the courts. But we increased the funding in New York. And in addition to that approach, New York has also worked to increase pro bono services, to provide additional human resources, and to assist legal service providers. We encourage our lawyers to give their time and resources, just as you do. And we have a bar that provides expansive pro bono services, just as you do. New York felt this was just not enough, and I know that, again, those of you in this room feel the same, that we are still falling short of the goal, despite the fact that you achieved your target money, and I assume they can keep on giving. I don't like to talk about money, but apparently I've done so for most of my talk here this morning. Our Court of Appeals then adopted a rule that mandates 50 hours of pro bono service for all those seeking admission. This rule is now part of our admissions process and has provided thousands of additional hours for the unmet needs of poor and low-income clients. The naysayers have been silenced, as now that 50-hour rule has been endorsed by law schools and the entire legal community, and we are very, very proud. And in fact, I now, because I do all the petitions by individuals who seek to get admitted to New York without satisfying a particular rule, I barely see anyone seeking to avoid this rule. This is now exceedingly well received and common in our experience. Another important project is our Pro Bono Scholars Program, which Attorney General McDonald mentioned earlier in his remarks. The program allows a cohort of third-year law students to spend their last semester of law school working full-time, providing pro bono services. And this particular project continues to be popular with students. They get to do great work for clients in need. In exchange, they take the February bar, and if they pass, and as it turns out, they pass at a very high rate, exceeding the average, they can complete their admissions process before their classmates, and they get a jump start on their legal careers. Our experience has been that many continue as public interest lawyers. Many have a job offer before they hit graduation date. And every year, increasing numbers of students apply to this program. Some schools just don't have enough seats to accommodate the students who want to participate. So we are thrilled by the interest and success of the pro bono scholars. Now, in addition to putting money into the judiciary budget, in addition to the efforts on pro bono work, and those are really the pillars of our efforts in New York, we have other initiatives that we have tried, perhaps not as